Good evening, everyone. It is a pleasure to be back to this house, which I feel as my own, by its joy and friendship and caring that I receive when I'm here. So thank you very much to everyone that is part of Broward Spiritist Society. And tonight I am touched by the presence of a person that is dear, very dear, that is Rodrigo Peralva. Last time I was here, we were talking about the reincarnation of Allan Kardec in Chico Xavier. And the main testimonial presented here was by his grandfather, Martin Peralva Sobrino. And I consider him my spiritual father for 30 years of friendship, more than 30 years, almost 40 years. And I tell you this, after Chico Xavier, he was the most sensitive, delicate, and polite and humble person that I ever met. Martin Peralva, then it's a joy to be here with Rodrigo, his wife, and his daughter. Thank you very much for your presence here. They live here in USA, in Gainesville. Therefore, 5 hours trip, so it is an honor to have them here. This whole effort to come here, to hear us, thank you very much.
Pode parecer, como é que mexe aqui? Da outra vez deu problema, hein?
Nosso tema. Our topic is the extraterrestrial life. According to Allan Kardec and Chico Xavier's books. And this is interesting because until today, when we talk about this topic in the spiritist centers of Brazil and the rest of the world, people go like, wow. Some of them actually don't like that we talk about this topic, like if it was a taboo, right? And we don't understand why this taboo. Since our decoder, Allan Kardec, already wrote about this topic almost 160 years ago, posing the question about the plurality of the inhabited worlds as one of the basic principles of Spiritism. The decoder of Spiritism himself, when he elaborates the Spirit's book and all the following books, so he will put mainly in the Spirit's book 14 basic principles of Spiritism. And one of the 14 basic principles, he denominated one of them of plurality of inhabited worlds. Well, if the worlds are inhabited, there are extraterrestrial beings living there, yes or no? This question comes from the 19th century. And why in the 21st century, more than a century later, still we don't talk, we don't discuss, and we don't study this topic in the Spiritist centers? This is very interesting, and I don't know why. And based on this, we will see that this is not news into Kardec's works, because Jesus was talking about this as well. 2,000 years ago, 20 centuries ago, Jesus of Nazareth was already talking about this topic. And in our conversation here tonight, we will talk about what Jesus, Kardec, and Chico Xavier spoke about this topic. What Jesus said about this, everybody knows. It's there in the book of John the Evangelist, chapter 14, verses 2. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Jesus himself guiding us. Obviously, he didn't give any other details because back then the scientific resource was scarce. and the difficulty humanity had back then to understand life and life beyond Earth.
Da vida terrestre. E por isso ele falou isso.
And that's why he said like so, in my father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And as I mentioned, Kardec will say the subject about the plurality of the inhabited worlds. What about Chico Xavier? Did he talk about this? It is funny that we see people in the Spiritist movement, even people with good knowledge, saying, I never heard that Chico Xavier said anything about this. It seems that they never read any of Chico Xavier's book before. There are today 499 books published regarding his direct writings or interviews, that he answered questions in the name of Emmanuel, the Spirit. It was always Chico Xavier and Emmanuel, the dynamic duo. Many of those interviews also became books, and the information is out there, available, necessary only for us to access them. Well, books were not created to be on the shelf, right? There are people that buy a lot of books, especially in Spiritist book fairs, and they buy all those books and they put in the shelf and it stayed there. And the books, they stay there in the shelf. We need to study and we need to look for information. Information that are available for us and for our guidance. When we created this slide, Chico had 497 books published, now got two more. Even after his death, he's still working. More than 60 books about him were published after his death. We will also talk about what he told me in a few opportunities personally there in Uberaba about this subject. And as I mentioned before, the books that were written by his mediumship will bring important information about extraterrestrial life through those wonderful books that came to us through his mediumship, messages from several spirits through his mediumship. I brought you today some books that will talk about this subject, this topic. In the book On the Way to the Light of Emmanuel, mediumship of Chico Xavier, the book Divine Justice, also by the spirit Emmanuel, also talks about the life of the extraterrestrials. The book Renunciation, the epic, last epic romance by the spirit Emmanuel. We'll also talk about this subject. Also by Emmanuel, the book Consoler, and by André Luiz, Evolution in Two Worlds. The book Letters from a Dead Woman, one of the first messages that Chico Xavier started to receive through his mediumship. And it was his own mother. It's not me, it's the spirits that want to speed up the slideshow. That's why the slide is jumping. So in this book, a letter from a dead woman, it's his mother that she came after her death, and through his mediumship, she was talking about the extraterrestrial life. This was one of the first messages that he received. And those letters, those communications, became a book in 1935. Also in the book, It Would Not Be in 2012, edited by Dr. Marlene Nobre, by the Spiritist magazine of São Paulo. It contains my interviews talking about what Chico Xavier told me. Now we are going to 1971. There is Chico Xavier in 1971 in a TV show Pinga Fogo. Till today in Brazil, the most watched TV show in the history of Brazilian TV. 94% of the TV sets in Brazil were connected to the Tupi channel from São Paulo during 4 hours of TV show to watch Chico Xavier in the first semester of 1971, and the first TV show before Christmas in the same year, the show called Pinga Fogo that became DVD, you can watch until today, and became book. Saulo Gomes' books, the journalist from that time, interviewed Chico Xavier, is even more complete. Connected to the Candeia distributor, it's even more complete because it has the transcripts, the exact transcript of everything he was asked, and everything that Chico answered is the book of. In that moment, Chico will say, we're going to listen to him saying, because we brought the video of this exactly part. And we are on the threshold of new times when science will unveil for us all an immense future before the universe. Listen to how Chico Xavier says something really important. We spiritists, this is not our job to unveil all this, no. It's not Spiritism's job. It's not the job of mediumship to unveil the life of extraterrestrials. Whose task is that? The science. Science itself will reach this point. And today we have an instrument on Earth. Now on June 24th, we'll celebrate 70 years of existence, which is ufology. The study of the research of information and research regarding a phenomena called unidentified flying objects. In Portuguese, OVNIs, in English, UFOs, and ufology is a science which is becoming a science that will be 70 years this June. So you see Chico saying, these are new times. We are on the thresholds of these new times. And a lot of people may be scared by this picture, the extraterrestrial, according to how some people describe them. And Chico will say in a TV show, Pinga Fogo, of 1971, we will understand that we are part of a universal family. We are part of a universal family. That we are not the only world, the only planet created by God. This is a sign of the new times. When it is not news or marvelous anymore, when it's not hypothetic anymore or a joke, this fundamental reality for us as humanity, we are brothers of other billions of humanity spread out in the cosmos. And Chico Xavier will say this in 1971, live in the Brazilian TV. And he's the first religious personality in the world brave enough to admit this reality in front of the TVs. In a live TV show, until then, any other religious authority from any other religious school or spiritualist segment admitted that in public, like Chico Xavier in a TV show, Pinga Fogo. Let's listen to it just a few minutes. our colleague from Global Channel, our humanity witnesses at this moment another dramatic move of the space race when Apollo 15 is heading for the moon. Do the spiritual teachers of Chico Xavier believe if in our present civilization men can get in touch with civilizations of other planets? We are subordinating the answer to the same criterion with which the information was structured for our dear interviewer who spoke about the new era. If we do not enter into a war of extermination in the next 50 years, then we can expect extraordinary achievements of human science from the moon. Then says our Emmanuel, who is present, that when Christopher Columbus wandered through the European courts seeking help to discover an easier way for the India, many people considered his program as absolutely useless to mankind, that it was an utterly inauspicious expense and which would go far too much in the budget of any people until he got the support of Fernando and Isabel of Castile. But we all know after almost five centuries, more than four centuries ago, the importance of the dawn. So we cannot also accuse our brothers who are going to the moon for research that should be considered of the utmost importance for our future, because the expense incurred in doing so will naturally be compensated with perhaps the tranquility for a more peaceful society on Earth, because if not, for example, in conflict of immense proportions, then on the moon it is possible for a man to construct glass cities, greenhouse cities, where scientists can establish points of support for the observation of our galaxy. These cities are not a dream of science. These cities, naturally, with much sacrifice of earthly humanity, can be done, and we'll probably say if we can get nitrogen and oxygen in mills, let's say aluminum and glass formation of plastic and matter on the moon itself, for the construction of earth science strongholds, and probably the water will be supplied by the lunar soil itself. Who knows the possibility of getting in touch with other communities in our galaxy? So we will definitely end the war period in the evolution of terrestrial peoples, because we will understand that we are part of a universal family, that we are not the only world created by God. Jesus himself, whom we revere as our Lord and Master, said, "There are many mansions in my Father's house." So we need to honor the peace of the peoples, the tranquility of all, with respect for all, with the highest veneration for science, so that we can too gauge these benefits in the future, perhaps closer than we think if we deserve. Chico knew things, right? And here we are going to point out a few phrases, for example. The TV show is from 1971. You heard him saying about the next 50 years, didn't you? Right. Clear, right? Chico Xavier said it. I did not say it. For me, In private conversation with him in 1986, he will say that the beginning of this 50-year term began when the men stepped on the moon, when North America, here very close to you, launched Apollo 11 in Cape Canaveral. Hence, a few days later, they descended on the lunar soil in July 20th, 1969. And what is the condition? Chico also talks about it. What is the condition? If he says, if we do deserve it, that is not what he said in the end of his explanation. If we do deserve it, we will have great achievements in the future. After this 50-year term that began in July 1969, he speaks a very important thing here as well. If we overcome the period or warlike impulse of terrestrial humanity, if we as nations, as responsible collectiveness, mainly those who are in command of the armored forces of the world in the United States of America, Great Britain, or France, Italy, Russia, India, Pakistan, and especially the nations that have nuclear power, if they win the military impulse, we are going to deserve a new phase. A new dawn for humanity is what we deal with on the DVD. Deadline, according Chico Xavier, which is also based on a DVD, and the book, it will not be in 2012. Also, after the book was made a DVD, the deadline, according to Chico Xavier. We are living in a crucial moment. We are today in 2017. We are at the end of the 50-year period. It is 2.5 years just so that this exception period revealed by Chico Xavier is expired, but it must be overcome in peace. It is necessary that the terrestrial humanity overcomes its self-destructive drive to the nations, to nations of great responsibilities, and especially here in the United States of America, China, we forgot China, and all who have the military power of weapons of mass destruction, do not use them, and do not put them to disposition of the killing, because only them humanity will continue and will progress. From 2019 on, an acceleration of progress, what Chico will tell me the following, he will tell me that if we only pass this period of 50 years in peace, none of us can predict the advances, the advancement that we will have from July of 2019. Advances in the field of science, in the field of medicine. He even specifies that medicine would come to discover the cure of all diseases of the physical body, all physical diseases. See how wonderful this is. In the field of sociology, economics, where there will be more progress and more access to all population, regardless of where they are located. Chico will also talk about extraterrestrials, because he told me that only from starting July 2019, if humanity wins the test, pass this test of 50 years, it is as if we are before a huge trial. All humanity incarnated and discarnated, because the society of the incarnated and discarnated interpenetrate. One is not dissociated from other, right? If we will pass this test, we are facing this test, this trial. And this proof is to pass these 50 years without a nuclear war, without the so-called the Third World War. You have to warn everyone because it starts in us, right? The war begins in us, begins in each of us, begins at home, begins in each institution, and we all have to. Chico made a recommendation and also exercised it, not only spoke about it, he did it. He did said, pray for the nations that are more militarized. He prayed back then in 1986 for the President of the United States of America, the first European ministers, Russia, which that time was Union of Soviet Socialist Republics before Gorbachev. He always prayed for these rulers. Why? So that they may be enlightened in moments of decision, because without a doubt, temptation may arise. We must tame that warrior impulse. He told me if humanity passes these 50 years trial and from there begins the accelerated progress, in 2057, the Earth will enter into a condition of the regenerating worlds. And then, yes, and then we will integrate the community of the planets of extraterrestrial civilizations that are living in the condition and the state of worlds of regeneration. And then what he said of 1971 will make sense. We will understand that we are not the only planet created by God, and that we are part of a large universal family. Then, as a devil's advocate, I asked, and if we fall in temptation, and if the third world war happens, when this world of regeneration will come? And then he said, oh, my son, and you can expect the year 3000. We will have 9 centuries ahead of reconstruction. So I ask you guys, do you want to work in the regenerated world already in this incarnation? For us, for our children, for our grandchildren, or do you want to be still 9 centuries ahead, struggling, rebuilding what you was destroyed, will be destroyed? The option is only one, the way of peace. There is no other way. It doesn't exist. The only way is the peace and progress continuously. We do have this challenge, this modern times, this planetary transition. We are living in the midst of this planetary transition, and everything is coming up. So what is the goal? The goal is to get to this point, the regeneration world. We are getting out of this condition of world of regeneration. What is the characteristic of a world of atonement and trials? Materialism, selfishness, pride, vanity. These are the characteristics of a world of trials and atonement. What is one of generation? It is not a perfect world yet. Still a world with difficulties, but the majority of the population works for the fraternity, for harmony, for peace, for union, right? Most people work for the collectiveness. And in a way, we Spiritists and many other religious schools working for peace are already living in a world of regeneration. And the spirit of Dr. Barry, who speaks to Kardec in the book of Genesis, chapter 18, about the transition period, says, work not for the present, but for the future. Spiritism is a work directed towards the future of the humanity. We are sowing the future of humanity, preparing the ground for seeds to leave the soil and grow to flourish and fruit, so that the future of the world of regeneration, and it's the world of the generation, will be integrated into the great interplanetary community. Better said, the world, the planets around us. And to demonstrate that why we know that we are at this point of the planetary transition, Kardec, in the book of Genesis, chapter 18, item 10, announcing the period of renewal that would open for humanity, it was lawful for Jesus to say, look here, Kardec says that was lawful for Jesus, our Lord and Master, to say that the end, the transition, the end of the old world. Many people are confused with the end of the world. It is not the end of the world. The end of the world means the end of the period of atonement and of trials, but at the same time, the beginning of another era. It is the time of regeneration. So it was lawful for Jesus to say that the transition would be marked by four things: extraordinary phenomenon, earthquakes, several scourges, sign in the sky. Well, Chico Xavier's life was an extraordinary phenomenon. We do not have, unfortunately, we don't have a Chico Xavier in each of our families. If we had, we would be already in a happy planet. But no. But he's a missionary who came from above to spread love, harmony, and wisdom, to give this impulse so that humanity could move forward. Earthquakes, look what is happening. This is patent. From the year 2000 to here has increased, and much, the frequency of earthquakes and tsunamis in the world. Various scourges, several types of scourge, in the field of health, in the field of dispute. It is everywhere. Let's look at the last one, signs in the sky. What Kardec meant by these signs in the sky? Kardec is referring to the speech of Christ that there would be signs in the sky. I have no doubts to say and affirm that that is exactly the phenomena of unidentified flying objects apparitions that nobody knows, and nobody knows where they're coming from and what they're doing here, but they are here. It is not a coincidence. It is not a coincidence that the phenomena of Roswell from here, the United States, inaugurated to the world the so-called ufology. And what was the day that this happened? June 24th, 1947. June 24th is the day of John the Baptist. It is the day of the Spirit of Truth. John the Baptist, there in Brazil, we celebrate the St. John's on June 24th. Is the day that the Catholic Church and the Orthodox Christian churches dedicate to John the Baptist, the forerunner of Jesus, the cousin of Jesus, who came to prepare the way for Jesus. John the Baptist assigned to himself the task of the truth, and after the truth would come love, right? And it is precisely on this day that one of the greatest phenomena of apparitions registered in the world happens, and and it is inaugurated this science. I will call science, many people think it is not a science, but it is the way of being science, of ufology. That is exactly what Kardec speaks in the chapter 18 of Genesis. Signs in the sky and the frequency. Other interesting information on ufology is the frequency of the apparitions of these objects, which was way less before 1957. The peak begins during the explosion of the first bombs here in the United States, the first bombs, nuclear bombs in the United States, in the New Mexico, when the United States was experimenting the nuclear power of the atom. And from there, mainly from there, they begin to appear, the aliens, the unidentified flying objects. Concerned, nothing, you guys, they were applauding us. Chico Xavier explained to me later, they were worried about us, very much concerned. 2 days ago, actually, I posted on my Facebook one of the astronauts, Edgar Mitchell, who participated in Apollo 11, that took the man to the moon for the first time. Edgar Mitchell said in an interview, said that aliens prevented the World War III intervene directly on Earth, in earthly society, preventing us from doing this stupidity of entering into a third world war. It all makes a lot of sense, right? As I said in the beginning, the subject is not new. The subject is very, very old. Jesus already spoke about it. And before Jesus, the Druids, in fact, Allan Kardec is the name of a Druid priest who lived 100 years before Christ, there in the Gaels, in Brittany, where today is France. The Druids, Kardec was a priest 100 years before Christ was a priest. One of the basic principles of Druidism was precisely the plurality of the inhabited worlds. See how this knowledge is ancient. We can also refer to India. The Vedas speak about extraordinary things recorded, including what they call Vimanas, nothing more than interplanetary ships that visited them. Even there he has a description of a war in the air with flying objects that they called Vimanas. Like I said, as the subject is old, Jesus speaks about this. In my Father's house are many mansions. And Kardec will speak in research on this from the year 1 of the Spiritist magazine. As early as March 1858, there is a comment from him that says, "Why the earth, a small imperceptible globe in the immensity of the universe, among many others, would be the only dwelling of rational and thinking beings." He's asking, why do we think we are all that in a bag of chips? How come? The most evolved beings created by God, human beings on Earth. Come on, to think this is too much. What wise man, Kardec asks, would believe that millions of stars that glittered over our heads were only meant to entertain our eyes? If we live here today and if the night is clear, cloudless, then we could admire billions and billions of stars, constellations, galaxies. The number of galaxies, recently we got into the conclusion that there are 2 trillions galaxies. I cannot even imagine that many numbers, right? 2 trillion galaxies. See, our Milky Way is one galaxy. Our Milky Way. Among 2 trillion. How many suns has the Milky Way? Does anyone know the answer? 5 years ago, we thought it was 200 million suns. Sorry. 2 billion suns. But we now know that there are 600 billion suns. And our sun is just one, only one, amongst 600 billion suns. What are suns? Suns are stars. 600 billion stars in our Milky Way, in our interplanetary city, which is a city. But there are 2 trillion cities, and we, humans, are the only ones intelligent, thinking being created by God. For the love of God. Actually, the phrase is intentional, for the love of God, because the love of God is much greater than our pretended vanity can suppose. And of course, this is not all empty. Everything has lives, movement everywhere. That's why Kardec is amazed, asking, is it possible that someone believes? Is it possible that anyone would believe that all this around us would be just to entertain our visions at night? That's not possible. He asks, what would be the usefulness of these millions of globes, millions of lands invisible to the naked eye? What would be the use? If that would be true, God would be a great landowner. All this immensity of land and only a little house in the middle of that, all that life. Can it be? Could it be? Does not make any sense. We have come to conclude, Kardec continues, for the plurality of the inhabited worlds. See, isn't Kardec the reasoning in person? He first asks, and then he concludes, naturally supplied by spiritual information. We have come to conclude by the plurality of the inhabited worlds, and this reasoning is confirmed by the revelations of the spirits. Spiritism belongs to whom? Ours? No. Spiritism is of the spirits, and Kardec is here affirming that the spirits affirmed to him, confirmed to him the plurality of the inhabited worlds. All these worlds are inhabited by corporeal beings, appropriated to the physical condition of each globe. And here is he's already enunciating laws for our understanding. All these globes are inhabited by corporeal beings. And we are not saying that these are smoke. These are bodies of extraterrestrials. Now, these bodies are proportional to the physical condition of each planet. So, it is no use thinking you are going to send a ship from here on the land on Mars and photograph the Martian life, because there is another terrestrial globe, another planet other than Earth. The conditions there are different. We will talk about this on Monday with the continuation of this talk. Another question that Kardec writes here is that among the inhabitants of those worlds, some are more advanced and other less advanced than ourselves. Wait, there are people there less advanced than us. We are not so bad like that. One day, Chico said to me, we are not in the beginning of the journey. We are halfway there. It is already something, right? And Kardec is talking about this here. There are those who are more advanced than us, and those that are less advanced than us, from a moral and even physical intellectual point of view, because things come together. So there are extraterrestrial civilizations far more advanced than us, and also civilizations less advanced than us. Which one do you want to visit? It's easier for us to visit less advanced, right? Isn't it? No. Nobody wants it. Nobody wants it. Okay, let's move forward. So Kardec continues. People, this here, few people study this text. That is in Spiritist magazine of Allan Kardec. It talks about amazing things. We will now see. Even more, we know today that we can have a relationship with them. We, human beings here on Earth, can get in tune in communication with extraterrestrial beings. What is that? Mediumship. Mediums, yes, they can communicate with other spirits from other planets. That's not too much. It is not a big thing. It is logical. Why? Mediumship is thought to thought. Thought has no boundaries. And the more advanced, they help us to move forward. They inspire us in progress. Excuse me. I'm sure a lot of spirits are inspiring physicists, astrophysicists, who are medium as well, there at NASA and other parts of the world, who are running research. Not only get in touch with them, but get from them information about their status. I participated in Brazil now last year, at the end of July, the 5th World Forum of Contactees. Who are the contactees? They are just human beings, people that were contacted by extraterrestrial civilizations. And there were Americans from California, another one from Canada, British Columbia, several Peruvians and Italians and Brazilian people from all over the world talking about this, that Kardec was already saying that the extraterrestrials were communicating with us, transmitting information about their lives, about its civilization, its progress, its life, anticipating for us information about this. And we will say here that Chico Xavier did this. In several books, Chico Xavier got information and has printed in his books. We know equally, proceeds Allan Kardec, that not only all globes are inhabited by corporeal beings. Folks, this information is extraordinary. Almost 100 years, Kardec is anticipating the ufology. In almost 100 years, this was written more than 100 years, because this was written by Kardec in 1858, and ufology will arise in 1947, but the conclusions will only arise in the decade of the 70s. So, that space is not only the globes where there are corporeal lives, but the space is populated by intelligent beings. The space between the planets, to us, invisible because of the material veil, and who reveal their existence by hidden means or patents. Here Kardec is speaking of the intermediary planes, the multiple universes, the spiritual realm that interpenetrate between the corporeal planets. And he concludes this speech by saying, so everything is populated in the universe. Life and intelligence are everywhere, in the solid globes, or in the planets, rather, in the air, in the core of the earth. Kardec saying this, in the core of the earth, in the experience of the contactees, exactly this, which they call intraterrestrial civilizations. Allan Kardec already spoke about this, in the core of the earth and even in the ethereal depths. Thank God that Kardec is saying this, right? Otherwise, I would be burned. They would burn me alive. But you can check this in a Spiritist magazine. And now, Kardec asks, will there be in this doctrine something that repulses reason? No, there is not. Isn't it the same time, at the same time, grand and sublime? It elevates us by our own littleness, quite contrary to this selfish and petty thought, which places us as the only beings worthy of occupying the thought of God. What Kardec is saying, what repulses the reason, is exactly the opposite of this. Those stubborn who still in the 21st century insist on finding that there is only intelligent life on earth. This is no longer acceptable. In the book of Genesis, chapter 14, we will see on page 133, subtitled Fluids, a very important page of Kardec. He will say, in the unknown planets that are around you, a portentous diversity unimaginable is spread by such eternal dwellings that wander in the spaces. Is it difficult to understand regarding the diversity in that plurality of life of inhabited worlds? There are a plurality of the inhabited worlds. It's one of the basic principles of Spiritism, but we can't think that it's all like on Earth, because the Spiritism explains the manifestation of life on each planet is proportional to its condition of physical, spiritual habitability, atmospheric conditions, of combinations of material elements. We human beings, we have some what we call building blocks for our lives, such as carbon, oxygen, hydrogen, but it is already speculated that there may be worlds that the building blocks are silicon, different material. Life is diverse. Kardec says clearly, a portentous adversity, so unimaginable, is spread out in different worlds. Is it difficult to imagine that? No, it's just we observe life here on Earth. We are on a, we breathe the air. We need oxygen, hydrogen, the sun, and the marine life. Do they breathe like us? Fishes, the mammals like whales. No, it's totally different. What about the deep sea, where they don't have the light of the sun? Thousands of meters in the deep sea. The abyssal fossils of Japan. Also the fossils of the Caribbean, the abyssal fossils of the Caribbean. The sunlight cannot penetrate in the amount of water that exists in 10 or 11 kilometers of water, deep sea. They have sent robots there to film the life of the crabs and the fossils and the abyssal fossils, naturally very different from the crabs that we know. Different fishes and beings, completely different from what we know, from what we see. But they exist and they are there, learning, living. Imagine in a space, in the cosmos, all those planets and moons and solar systems and galaxies. It is really fantastic. That's why this Spiritism is fantastic. Almost 160 years. This year we will celebrate 160 years on April 18th of the Spirit's book. We have to celebrate because it anticipates a lot of things. Like Chico said in the beginning, it's not for the Spiritism doctrine to unveil this truth, but because it's the movement of the truth, it spreads the prescience of human society, because later on we will understand what the spirits were saying 160 years ago. Like today, that we have this beautiful work of Chico Xavier, almost 500 years, and it's destined to the future. All this works is destined to the future. A lot of physicians see that in André Luiz's books, that a lot of things that André Luiz have written through Chico Xavier in the decades of 40s and 50s, they were confirmed in the decades of 80s and 90s. So we are moving on. This part of the very interesting part of Kardec's text is the answer of the Spirit's book of the question 181, the multiverse reality. The beings that inhabit different worlds have bodies different from ours, and according to the conditions of the world in which they inhabit. This envelope, however, is more or less material according to the degree of purity to which they have arrived. So here's another direction. The more evolved the spirit is in the path of evolution, their bodies of manifestation are more subtle, but they are bodies. We can call them bodies, perispirits, perispiritual envelope. The spirit of André Luiz even classifies seven bodies. He speaks about the astral body, the mental body, the causal body. There are several bodies. His works will deal with it. There are seven bodies in total, counting with the human physical body, the double ethereal spiritual body, in which is the astral body, the mental body, the causal body. All this is bodies. It is matter. And As the spirit evolves, this materiality ceases to be necessary. It is being purified. So the civilizations, for example, 10,000 years more evolved than ours, they will have more subtle bodies and evolved than ours. A civilization with 1 million years ahead of us, for us it's the unthinkable, 1 million years. And 1 million years is nothing in the history of the universe. We are talking about the universe's theory, the Big Bang theory, that there are at least 13 billion and 600 million years that the known universe exists, the one that we have been observing, 13 billion and 600 millions. How many civilizations have developed and evolved and advanced in those 13 billion and 600 million years? Just to get an idea, the terrestrial human being, who is the Homo sapiens sapiens, it is not woman sapiens, please, but Homo sapiens sapiens, here on Earth has evolved over the past 200,000 years. And that's it, that's nothing, just a second in the evolutionary history of the known universe, not mention those we do not know. In this book, extraordinary book, now we're going to talk about Chico Xavier, The Consoler, the book The Consoler. Like Kardec asked the spirits in the spirits book and the medium's book in the beginning of the mediumship of Chico Xavier, the spiritists from Rio de Janeiro and Pedro Leopoldo, they asked questions to Chico Xavier, and it became a book and was published by the Brazilian Spiritist Federation. In the question 73, is the terrestrial humanity identical with other orbs? See the connection between Emmanuel and Kardec. We just showed the question 181 from the Spirit's book, saying that the bodies are proportional to the evolution of each orb, each planet. So Emmanuel will say here, in physical expression, such analogy is impossible. In face of the substantial laws governing each evolutionary plane. In other words, no, the humanities of other worlds, of extraterrestrial worlds, are not similar to Earth. The terrestrial humanity, from the physical point of view. Why? Because the physical point of view presupposes a certain pre-existing condition of matter association, environment, the existence of certain physical elements, as, for example, oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen, right? So life can organize, like on Earth, how it was organized here on Earth. Emmanuel says, no, it's not the same, and it can't be the same, but let's understand by humanity our spiritual family of all creatures which populate the universe, and examined the question from this prism, we will see that the terrestrial community perfectly identified with the universal collectivity. Although then we are different, we are brothers of each other. We are a family, right? We are going to talk about this on Monday, but the mother of Chico Xavier, who died in 1915, she is invited by the spiritual mentor, her spiritual mentor, to visit Mars, Saturn, to visit a planet in another star, in a different star, a different star trine system, which she describes it very beautifully. For her, Dona Maria, the Saint John of God, the beings that she saw in Saturn were ugly, although they were a cultural, intellectual, a spiritual capacity and much more advanced than we can presume. Now, one of the most beautiful, brilliant pages of the mediumship of Chico Xavier, it's by André Luiz, the spirit of André Luiz. In this book, Evolution in Two Worlds, here we have the two covers, the oldest and the current one, published by the Brazilian Spiritist Federation. In the beginning of the book, André Luiz will compare. André Luiz is comparing our Milky Way, that in which the solar system is integrated. He compares our galaxy, which our science says that today exists in this galaxy 600 billion stars, 600 billion suns. He compares to a big interstellar city. This is very beautiful. And about this, how it was formed, how all this was formed. And of course, it was necessary a much superior, far superior intelligence to coordinate all this. And André Lee says, the universal cosmic fluid is the primary element where live and vibrate constellations and suns, worlds and beings, like fish in the ocean. He compares the whole universe as if it were an ocean, and every galaxy is compared to a fish in that ocean. In that universe operate a glorious intelligence that take the plasma and convert it into cosmic habitations of multiple expressions, like the dwellings that last for millennia. So he's speaking about the great engineers of sidereal architects. Emmanuel also talks about it in the book On the Way to the Light. Jesus, who is Jesus? Jesus, our Lord and Master, is one of those glorious intelligences. The evolutionary condition, it is within these intelligences. That's why we call him Christ, because it is a being which is not a human being. He's an angelic being who has passed through humanity. Emmanuel says that the planets where Jesus evolved have already been lost in the dust of the centuries. They no longer exist. It is not hard to imagine that, because he is the organizer of the earth, he who presided over the formation of the earth. And we know today by science that the earth was formed about 4.5 billion years ago, 4.5 billion years ago. At that time, he was already what he is, because Jesus presided over the formation of the earth. So he was. Therefore, he's one of those glorious intelligences that take the divine plasma and convert it into cosmic dwellings of multiple expressions, which dwelling in those dwellings endure for millennia. They form thus, says the spirit of André Luiz, stellar empires, and in the breasts of these astounding formations, matter, space, and time are structured, offering gigantic fields to the progress of beings. Everything has a logic. Everything has a definite purpose. Nothing is random. Nothing is like the chaos theory, as many assume on Earth, right? Materialists really like the chaos theory, the things that come together by chance, right? To form life, to form planets, by chance, all in chaos. That's everything is falling here and there, and the extraordinary things arises. Life arises. Someone was joking that if chaos theory were possible, it would be enough to throw several debris on Highway I-95, construction debris, and then a Boeing 747 would emerge. Imagine a plane created by chance and then flying out from the Miami airport. It's not possible. Everything has a reason. And what is the purpose? To unite matter, space, and time. Three fundamental things, which is actually just one. Einstein's theory of general relativity in the early 20th century. See, this is old. In the early 20th century, Einstein identified that all of this is one thing, matter, space, and time. These are forces that are available to the being so that they evolve, so that they progress. Now Emmanuel, in a book, The Path of Light, we'll speak more specifically about what I said of the Milky Way, comparing the Milky Way as an interstellar city. This is very interesting because actually this is one of my favorite books by Chico Xavier. These two, The Evolution into Worlds and a Path of Light by Emmanuel, they almost complement itself, showing the spiritual evolution of these two spirits that not by chance were chosen to bring this information to us. Let's see what he says here. Emmanuel throw us under the bus here, but let's move on. Taking the sun and the planets as our neighbors, like a building apartments, here he is comparing the solar system to a small building. The sun as our star, the center of the organization of our star system, and the planets in the sequence, Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, etc. Emmanuel makes a comparison of a building where each planet represents one floor of that building. So the Earth would be the third floor, right? Let me ask you this. Why are the extraterrestrials so worried about us? Let's think about it. If we live on the third floor, we can fight a lot between each other. But if we set fire on the third floor, we cannot. What do you think? Is anyone here a landlord? Would that be okay? No, right? Because if I set fire on the third floor, it will affect the fourth floor, the fifth floor, and everything else, right? If I take a bomb and explode indoors to kill my entire family, this bomb can destroy the entire building. The building may fall, right? That's why the extraterrestrials are interested in us, because our ignorance can lead them to their ruin. And that's why they are rather interfering in terrestrial evolution, because they cannot let that we come to destroy ourselves, because our self-destruction would be destruction for them as well. Continuing with the reasoning, we are a small building. Our house is not the most humble, thankfully, right? We are not so bad, not so humble. But we are in the favelas. The sun is a favela building in the Milky Way. No big deal. For you to have an idea, the frequency of stars the size of the sun with the same luminosity, the same temperature, is about 60% of the other stars. We are very common. Ordinary. 60% of the stars in the Milky Way are like the sun is. Now Emmanuel talk about something very interesting here. It is to humiliate us. He says, but apart from our edification, there are palaces and skyscrapers, such as Betelgeuse, Arcturus, Antares, and many others, seigneurial residences and imposing and beautiful, displaying a glory before which all our values would fade. Can you imagine? In our interstellar city, we surprise millions of homes in the most diverse dimensions and shapes, of which life and experience swarm victorious. This, instead of putting us down, it's even stimulating us to dream, to seek the highest. We human beings, we have our feet nailed to the ground so that we are all well attached to our present reality. But we have our heads on top of our physical organization so that we can look up at the sky, so that we can look up, so that we aspire to progress, aspire to look up. And to look at the wonders there are there for us. It is a lot of this in things in this book. We are going to find a lot of information and very important information, and one of them about the Capella's exile, right? Capella is a star and a constellation of Auriga, located about 90 light years from Earth. It's a binary system, and here Emmanuel will say that in a past, a distant past, there was a migration of spirits, unrepentant, rebellious, stubborn. Capella, the planet, on that occasion was exactly where the Earth is today, that is, out of the world condition of atonement planet and entering the condition of a planet in regeneration. And on that occasion, these impenitent and revolting spirits were exiled from there. So that's why the Bible has this image of Adam and Eve. They ate an apple and were expelled from paradise. And you can find this in the historical and legendary editions of all the sacred writings. And Emmanuel will now rationally explain to us what has happened. In 1938, he will write through Chico Xavier saying, there is a great star in the constellation of the Auriga, which is called the Capella, magnificent sun between the stars there that are closer. It makes itself accompanies equally of its family of worlds. So Capella also had several worlds. Look how interesting. Almost all the worlds which are dependent on have already been purified physically and morally, examined the conditions of moral backwardness of the Earth. 1,000 years ago, opening a parenthesis here, Chico Xavier told me that the number was 7,000 years ago, so 5,000 years before Christ. What happened there? There was a nuclear war there in Capella, and people responsible for the nuclear war on that planet were exiled to Earth. And the Spirit Emmanuel, in this book, On the Way to the Light, tell us in the following terms. For many millennia, one of the orbs of Capella, which maintains its affinities with the terrestrial globe, has reached the fulfillment of one of its extraordinary evolutionary cycles. A few million rebellious beings existed there, and a general sanitation action would take them away from that humanity. The great governing communities of the cosmos have deliberated, then relocated them here on Earth. But 5,000 years before Christ, 7,000 years ago, Earth was so backward, right? The Earth was a primitive world. With the arrival of the Capelinos, we had an upgrade. We have become a world of atonement and testing, because they have brought, of course, extraordinary strides. See the Egyptian civilization, the Hindu civilization, the Aryans, the Jews, the Hebrews. They are all Capelinos who came banished from there, from Capella. And they brought us something very, very important, the writing. Around 5,000 years before Christ, human beings begin to write their own stories. And then this story was born. And this needs to happen now, again, on Earth, the exile of inhabitants of Earth, who are unrepentant, delaying the progress of the Earth. And this is happening. Chico Xavier said that the exile of the inhabitants of Earth began in the Second World War. Great exile. And it's still happening. A lot. In that phrase of the Spirit Emmanuel, when he says, just give us a hint, say, one of the orbs of Capella that keeps many affinities with the terrestrial globe, and Chico Xavier told me, Jesus is the governor of Capella too. That is why we have so much affinity with Capella. But it's not just that. Jesus is the spiritual ruler, governor of five planets. A happy planet today in a Sirius star system. The planet Capella, which today is a regenerated planet. One of the planets which it revolves around the binary system of Capella. The Earth, which is a planet of atonement and testing, and the primitive planet called Chiron, where the exiled from Earth are going. If any of you would like to go now? But there, it's very good, because the lifestyle is like ours. The only difference is there you can find temperature, pressure, animals, and plants like the Earth, but with two differences. First, it's a bigger globe, a bigger planet than ours. And the second is the humanity is still cavemen. So the trip is free if you want to go and help the inhabitants of the caves of Chiron. There is no internet. Especially women that like to take care of their hairs, they can't over there. And just to finish the first part of our talk, we're going to cite the book Renunciation. In the beginning of the book Renunciation, Emmanuel will talk about the happy planet of Sirius constellations, solar system of Sirius. This is an image of the solar system of Sirius. And a detail about this book is Chico Xavier received this book in 1937, and Emmanuel will say that the solar system there in Sirius is a trine system. And the science used to say that it was a binary system. And the spirit of Emmanuel says there are three suns. And then after Hubble, more specifically another satellite went to the space to do to research about this. And now they got into the conclusion that it's a trine system, three suns. So 61 years later, after Chico Xavier got this book through his mediumship. This is Sirius, says Emmanuel, the marvelous sphere, unmistakable in magnificence and grandeur, the marvelous spectacle of its prospects, exceeded all that could characterize beauty in the human sense. Three shining suns poured into the ground, the oceans of miry light, unchanged changes, like celestial lamps lit for an endemic feast of immortal geniuses. What an elevation of verbiage. We'll remind your grandfather Peralva. He also would write like this. So look, he's talking about the extraterrestrial inhabitants of Sirius, saying there is also a planet governed by Jesus, a happy planet governed by Jesus. So that's why it's very like planet Earth. So this is according to the character of the book, Alcyone, which she was inhabited of planet Sirius, and she renounced all of this to incarnate on Earth. That's why the name of the book is Renunciation. And he describes, winged beings came and went, obeying sanctified goals in a work of a higher nature, inaccessible to the understanding of earthlings. We entered a temple of majestic proportions, mastered by untranslatable thoughts, far above the ship, radiant, a translucent tower rose, worked in a solid, transparent substance similar to the crystal, from whose interior harmonious melodies flowed. The August sanctuary was a vast beehive of labor and prayer. A brief description which the Spirit Emmanuel gave us about a happy world, a world that has overcome evil, ignorance, selfishness, envy, jealousy, strife, vanity. It has already reached the maximum development of human potential, of love, of mercy, of harmony, of wisdom. And see, the goal of a happy humanity, therefore, extraterrestrial beings who inhabit the happy world, a happy world, is here. You see, they obey sanctified goals in a work of a higher nature, inaccessible to human understanding. May Jesus help us one day to get there. Thank you very much.